end of another week, and the market has ended the week on strong footing. Things are looking up and up, at least in the short term. You're with us here on a fresh new edition of Taking Stock, the show where we look at the week which lies in front of us. Of course, we'll look at the week which is behind us to gain clues as to what happens next. I'm Prashant, as always, with me, my colleague Surabhi. Hi, Surabhi.
Hi, Prashant. What a week we've got. The bulls announcing that they're still alive and kicking and you can't write them off, right? That's what this week was really all about. Very, very quickly, let's just rewind back and take a look at what really transpired. Four trading sessions, a truncated week, but a superb performance. We are talking 6% gains on the board for the Nifty and a 12% up move on the Bank Nifty. What this week has done is that it has really diminished India's underperformance compared to the rest of the world. We're still underperforming most of the big global markets. I'll come to that plate in just a minute. But overall speaking, it's been really good. Financials rocking away, interest coming back in banks, plenty of short covering action as well because we had the monthly expiry also play out. In fact, stocks like ICICI Bank, HDFC Bank, Axis, I mean, these stocks have managed to run up between 13 and 15%. So you can't really write that off. But the comeback was not just limited to financials. The reason why this has been a roaring week for the market is that mid-caps also performed. The mid-cap index is up 4.5%. There was a wide sectoral performance as well coming in. For instance, two-wheeler stocks did so well. Most of the auto stocks are getting their mojo back, at least for now. Aisha would be, for example, case in point, which was up 18% for the week. But if you're looking at the rest of the market as well, the interest was back, whether it is some of the cement stocks earlier in the week or it was metals later. Risk-on is the theme. Speaking of themes, just a few points which perhaps explain the market's changed mood. First things first, the market seems to have put behind its disappointment with the 20 lakh crore rupee package. It's already looking forward. And what is it looking out for? It's looking at corporate commentary, and that this week was quite bullish. We spoke to a whole range of companies after their Q4 performance, and some of them told us, for instance, JSW Steel told us that they are back to 85% capacity utilization in the month of May. And those are the nuggets that the market is really holding on to. Construction has picked up in several green zones. So the market is looking at the economic reopening very, very carefully. On Monday, we will have more evidence of that. We'll know the new rules. We will know the new rules of play with respect to the lockdown. And the market is still holding on to hope that maybe we'll still have some policy intervention from the government or the RBI or maybe even both. So that's what it was all about, coming back strongly. I'll just leave with the plate of India versus the rest of the world versus some of the developed markets like the Dow, the DAX. We're still underperforming, but India is now down just about 3% in May compared to the 7% surge on the Dow. Some of the other emerging markets, I looked at the KOSPI, for instance, is up 4.5%. So we're still underperforming, but now not as badly as before. That's the overall action, but let's find out what really happened with stocks this week. Sonal is here with all of the details. Sonal.
Thanks a lot for that, Surabhi. Well, you mentioned financials. Those stocks did really well, but don't lose sight of the auto sector. Aisha Motors, the top Nifty gainer this week, up around 20%, because the company said that along with results, they will also be considering a stock split. Apart from that, we had Hero MotoCorp up 10% and the banking sector. That did extremely well. The top gainers were the likes of IndusInd Bank, ICICI Bank. We have the other banks that did well too. We have HDFC Bank, Axis Bank doing really well. Heavyweight L&T also did really well. Moving on to the losing names, there weren't many actually. We had Bharti Airtel losing around 7% this week, and some of the IT names, for instance, TCS lost around 3%. We had Infosys losing around 0.5% in trade. But let's move on to the broader markets. There also, there were more gainers than losers this time around. We had JSPL, Federal Bank after strong set of numbers. IDFC First Bank, majority of the gains came in from today's trading session. We had Chola Investment that did really well. Apart from that, Mothers and Sumi, Vodafone Idea on the back of FT reports that Google might be buying a stake in the company. Of course, the company denied those reports. We had Bail and DLF also doing well from the broader markets. On the losing side, we had Torrent Pharma after weak commentary from the management. Lupin also didn't do so well because it was a margin miss. We had Ashok Leyland and NIIT Tech amongst the other losers in the broader markets. Back to you.
Okay, all right. Thanks, Sonal, very much for that. So, Prashant, I mean, that's the week that was. What did you make of it? And what do you think of this market now? Because we are back to 95.50. And one wonders if this kind of excitement can continue.
The excitement may just feed on itself, Surabhi. So, you know, globally, we will get, of course, what Trump does about China. And that will come and go by the time we are back in trade on Monday. But the fact is that the bigger announcement is going to be with regards to what happens with the extension of lockdown 4. In all likelihood, there will be an extension. But in what shape and form, right? Will there be more relaxations, progressively more? Will states be given more power to regulate economic activity? Will that make a meaningful difference? I think all those are things which probably are a lot more important than what global markets are doing. Remember, you know, what also changed over the last 2 days is that, you know, India was hugely, grossly underperforming what the global markets were doing. And over the last 2 days, some of that has started to get corrected. We are nowhere close to, you know, performance in US, etc. But if the US market stays where it is, and, you know, the perception here is that things are easing up a little bit in terms of activity starting, then the market actually can continue to do, you know, better. Technically, there are two things to watch. One, the Nifty and the Bank Nifty are now above their short-term moving averages, the 20-day moving averages for both the Nifty and the Bank Nifty. Where do we head to? I mean, these are levels that I've got to our viewers many times in the past, actually, since the correction began and we got the first bounce and the first correction. For the Nifty, the first stop is 9,880. Basically, that is the 50% retracement of the entire fall from the Feb highs to 7511, which was the March 23rd low. The 50% retracement of that fall is 9880. The Nifty, you know, hit that 50%, and it also almost got to 61.8% retracement before collapsing again. So first stop on the Nifty, 9880. For the Bank Nifty, the first stop is a much weaker 22,060 level, 22060. That is the 38% retracement of the entire fall. The Bank Nifty, unlike the Nifty, did not go up to a 50% retracement. The bounce was much weaker. It was only 38%, and that's the level that I gave you. And you know, then the Bank Nifty collapsed after a much weaker bounce. So 9880 on the Nifty, 2260 on the Bank Nifty are the two levels, which means, I mean, if you are going to get to this, there is, I mean, some more upside as things stand right now. Surbhi.
Well, yes, we will have to watch out for some of these cues and how they play out. Let's take this discussion and the conversation forward. Joining in is Mihir Vora, Director and Chief Investment Officer at Max Life Insurance. Mihir, thank you for joining in. We hope you're doing well, keeping safe at home. So first things first, it feels better. I mean, the bulls definitely do feel better this week. Now, what do you think has brought about the sentiment change? And more importantly, can it continue?
Good afternoon, Surabhi, Prashant. Nice to be here. So I think it's just the sheer global strength that the US and European markets are showing, and Japan. So I think a bit of rub-off is now percolating down to India after having underperformed so much. If you look at the Dow Jones and the S&P is already above 3,000 levels, which is almost 80% of the fall has been retraced in the US markets. So I think India was lagging for quite some time. So that was one reason. And the fact that FII selling, of course, has reduced in the equity market. We did see a couple of good positive days also on the FII buying. So I think this whole gush of local liquidity, global liquidity, is kind of trickling down in a way to India also. I think the second big important factor was that this week itself, we had two or three big placements by corporates. In one instance, promoters selling a large chunk, and in the other instance, a large fundraising by one of the leading banks. And then the fact that such large blocks are able to go through in the market in quality names also gave a bit of a comfort to the market that all is not lost.
All is not lost. Okay, Mihir, so, if I could probe further, let's look at where the rally really came in from, and it was the comeback of the financials. Now, is this just a rally in what is a very deeply oversold part of the market, or do you think that it firmly puts in place a bottom, and perhaps we've seen the worst of the pessimism surrounding the moratoriums and the rising NPAs?
Too early to say whether the worst of the pessimism is past us, but you're right. It was amongst the most oversold parts of the market. As Prashant mentioned, the bounce back in the Bank Nifty was nowhere as sharp as the bounce back in the Nifty main. So to that extent, we are seeing a bit of a mean reversion trade in some of the bond out sectors. You know, we had sectors like telecom, pharmaceuticals, FMCG outperforming for quite some time. But now I think at least on the lower ticket consumption items like auto, etc., we might see some bounce back, and that's what the market seems to be gunning towards.
Mihir, so I mean, is there a reopening kind of theme which is likely to play out? Are you seeing some of that happening already in the market? What kind of positioning do you expect? Or which way do you think positioning will move as we move forward?
Again, we don't know in what form and shape the reopening is happening and which are the green zones, red zones likely to open up fast. But there are some indicators which are turning positive. For example, power demand is now down almost only like 5 or 10% on a YOY basis. So it just shows that there is some activity now beginning to come back. If you look at the Google traffic data, it does seem to indicate that in Bombay, Delhi, etc., traffic seems to be back to at least 35 to 50% of the original levels. So there are, you know, some indications that yes, things are falling in place. Some, you know, stirring of economic activity happening. But I think it will take a long time to get back to say 80% or 90%, given the seriousness of the situation. But having said that, markets, as we all know, are always a bit forward-looking. So the hope that at least in 2 to 3 months we'll be at least back to say 70 or 90% of the original levels can be a good enough trigger in some of the oversold pockets of the market.
The entire move we've seen in auto names, Mihir, what do you make of it? Do you think this is actual, I mean, this is also just technical adjustment, short covering kind of thing, or this is sustainable, that, you know, people are really taking longer term views now, that things are not going to improve anytime over the next few months, but, you know, dig in.
Yeah, absolutely, because I don't think anybody's expecting good numbers for the month of May, which is just going to be declared in a couple of days. I don't think there's a hope of good numbers coming out of May, because we know that dealerships are still not open, production is still not happening, inventory drawdown continues. So obviously, whatever moves we are seeing are forward-looking moves. The hope that 2 to 3 months down the line, things will come back into the picture. So what the market is probably doing, and I think which is what a lot of us are also doing, is we are actually just completely ignoring FY21 numbers. Even in terms of valuations, I think people are beginning to just assume a V-shape kind of or a bit of a U-shape recovery for FY22 and look at what the valuations look like for FY22, because FY21, I don't think anybody is looking at currently. And if you look at FY22 numbers and the fact that probably earnings might normalize back to FY20 numbers, then some of the sectors and segments do start to look interesting. And of course, we'll obviously have the growth kicker on a low base of FY21. So I think this is what, you know, at a certain valuation, a bomb.out stocks, bomb.out segments will start to look forward to.
Okay. So Mihir, you know, coming down to final thoughts, all things being equal, what is occupying top place in your portfolio?
I think the way we are playing it is on the consumption theme. So FMCG is anyway over it as a defensive as of now. But we are definitely beginning to look at some of the pockets in the auto segments with the 3 to 6 month expected recovery time. And some of the, you know, global segments that we have, like auto ancillaries, which are global in nature, IT pharma, which again are outward looking, telecom, which is showing signs of, at least stabilizing in terms of ARPU, et cetera. So those are the segments which look, better on a relative scale at this point in time. Financials, while we are underweight, we continue to think that there may be some time to go before we turn neutral. So we continue to maintain our little bit of underweight on the financial side.
All right, Mihir, thank you very much for joining in with some perspective on the market in a week that's been really one that belonged to the bulls. We need to take a very quick break. Now, we've discussed the fundamentals. Technicals become very, very important as well as the markets come back to levels last seen in the middle of May. We'll have Rohit Srivastava of India Charts joining in for just that. Welcome back. You are with us on Taking Stock. And as promised, now we are turning over to the technicals. Rohit Srivastava is with us for that. Rohit, good evening. Thank you for joining in. It's been a very strong comeback by the Indian market, right? Especially banks. Now, I just want to understand, first, looking at the Nifty, do you think this has more momentum and steam, or do you think the rally has run its course?
I definitely think there's more steam because what we've seen this week is a confirmation, at least from the short-term indicators. That is, when I look at the short-term rate of change or the momentum of the market, that turned to the buy side. And of course, as you were earlier discussing, that we've crossed over the 20-day moving average for both the indices, which is the Nifty and the Bank Nifty. Now, while doing so on the daily charts, on the weekly charts also, we already had the rate of change turning upwards, at least for the Nifty. For the Bank Nifty, we've seen it come very close to a crossover this week. But the Nifty is confirmed both on the daily and weekly indices. So that gives a clear sense that this trend is up, and I don't think it's done with. They'll most probably take out the highs that we saw in April, which means the 98.90 high for Nifty and the 21,900 high for Bank Nifty should get retested.
At the minimum, those are levels, Rohit, right? Or do you get a sense that this move could be bigger than that?
No, my sense is this is going to be bigger because, we of course stalled at the 50% retracement mark the last time. So, you know, when you made a higher bottom and started to head higher, most probably you're going to make a higher top. So you're going to go past these highs. These are just going to be the initial levels that we're going to watch. So what you will watch out for next is going to be two things. One is, of course, retracements. And the second is now look at the 20-week average. So we've discussed the 20-day average. We are above that. Now, the 20-week average, say, for the Nifty is going to be around 10,330. And for the Bank Nifty, it's going to be around, close to the 21,900, 22,000 mark, around the same place. No, in fact, it would be a little higher. So for the Bank Nifty, it would end up being closer to 24,000. So that's very, very far. Now, 24,000 for Bank Nifty would end up being a 50% retracement of the entire decline. Whereas for the Nifty, if we take a 61% retracement because you've already done 50%, then if we take it from the Feb high, it comes to 10,430. And if we take it from the Jan high, from the complete high, then we come to around 10,530. So I would sense that we are going to test the 61% retracement mark, whether it's 10,430 or 10,550. We'll watch out for that. And both of that will coincide now with the weekly averages. So weekly averages are now in the 10,330, 10,550 range. And same with Bank Nifty, the weekly averages are near the 50% retracement mark. So I think that's what we should be looking for, the next set of levels that we will probably go to above what we did in April.
Fair enough. Let's address the global also. Rohit, two or three most important things, that you're watching out for. I know you track U.S. equity indices, the dollar. How are things shaping up there?
So pretty well. In fact, the first thing which happened, I think, in the first 3 days of the week was that the S&P 500 crossed the 66% retracement mark, which was close to around 3,000. So that, I think, is the first thing which happened. And in that sense, it joins the NASDAQ, which had already done that. The NASDAQ, in fact, the NASDAQ 100 has gone past the 78% mark. It's also filled the gap down that we saw, which had actually developed post the crash, right? So when the crash started, we had a big gap down when the COVID thing really hit the world as a whole. And that gap has been filled, which means the NASDAQ is no more fearing, whatever happened in the past. And now with the S&P past the 66% mark, anybody calling that an intermarket divergence would have to now wait for seeing whether the S&P starts playing catch up with the NASDAQ and then they all continue high. So that's one thing. So we have that easing. The second important part with the dollar is that we always look at the dollar as the risk on risk off indicator and also one that tells us whether emerging markets or, the reflation trade really hits home. So the dollar index had been very strong in March when the crisis was hitting us, and all the Fed action has done is initially it stalled the dollar from going up, and it was in a range for almost 1.5 months. This week, we actually broke the lower end of the range. We went below the 99 mark, which is basically the trend line of all the lows from April. And breaking that now, I think the dollar index, both on daily and weekly charts, would be below the averages and is trending lower. So that's another sign of, fear going out of the market. When you look at the dollar, you think of money moving to other asset classes, whether it's emerging markets, whether it's commodities, and that then eases the pressure on currency markets across the world and makes it a much a better trade in terms of the risk on trade.
Hmm. Let's wrap this up with, what in your assessment here for viewers who are watching are the best ways to place this move up, best ways to play this move up that you think is coming in terms of sectors?
So my best allocation is likely to be in the reflation space, which is what happens when the dollar actually starts to go down, which means you get a gain either from metals or from rising prices. So you could get rising agro commodity prices, you could get rising metal prices. So that's one of the main areas that I would focus. The second one would be pharma itself, because pharma has been through a four-year bear market, which has actually come to an end. So that's another very, very interesting place. We've seen the first rally, which was very strong. So on a two-month basis, pharma stocks have been the best performers in the market. They've paused a bit, but I think that performance will probably continue. And lastly, I would really want people to go and look at value stocks and value investing, because the mid-cap stocks have been through a two-year bear market. In fact, so has the auto sector, which you were discussing some time back. All of them peaked in 2018. Even though the Nifty itself appears to have made its all-time high in Jan of this year, most stocks and sectors actually peaked in 2018. So they've been through a two-year bear market and are actually available in many cases at very, very low valuation. So, and you don't get these values unless there's bad news, right? So the old saying that buy when there's blood on the street actually fits very much over here, that stocks are available cheap because news is bad. Those are the stocks that you should look at, accumulating from a long-term basis.
Okay. All right, Rohit. Thank you for joining in and sharing your perspective on all the stocks that we have discussed. Well, with that, we will move on and look out for the events that would be important to track next week. Anisha is here with that list. Anisha.
Well, yes, guys, brace yourself for another hectic week, because while we will track the spread of COVID-19, because consistently throughout this week, the number of fresh cases has been over 6,000 per day. So whether it peaks out at some point of time or not is something that we need to keep on our radar. Separately, the RBI Monetary Policy Committee meeting, which was originally scheduled for 5th and 6th of Jan, has already been advanced. So that event is out of picture, but the street is still watching out for any comments coming in from the RBI or government with respect to providing fresh stimulus for the economy. Other than that, in terms of macro event, remember lockdown 4.0 comes to end on May 31st, and then lockdown 5.0 will start. Now, what is the shape of this lockdown 5.0 is something that we need to track. Apart from that, it's first day of the month, so we will get the auto sales data for the month of May. Very, very critical, because there has been resumption of activity in May. So what kind of pickup we have seen, this would be an early indicator of that. Another early indicator is that we'll get this week will be the PMI data, which will come not only for India, but a lot of economies. So we'll see what kind of manufacturing pickup as well as services pickup we have seen in the month of May. Apart from that, in terms of the global action, ECB will have an important meeting and they will decide the interest rate action, as well as their comments regarding quantitative easing, etc., will be important. Other than that, we're in the thick of earnings season. A lot of Nifty and large mid-caps will come out with numbers. Names like Britannia, L&T, Interglobe Aviation, SRF, Madison Sumi, amongst many others, will also report numbers. So yes, it is going to be a hectic week.
Okay, Anisha, thanks very much for that. So that's basically what you need to watch out for, a full lowdown of things to come. Well, that brings us to a close on this edition of Taking Stock from Surabhi, me, everyone. Thanks very much for staying with us. What we're going to do is leave you with some more expert opinion that we got through the course of the last four trading sessions. It was a holiday shortened week. The next one, of course, is a full one. Thank you very much for staying with us. We'll see you bright and early on Monday morning.
I think I wouldn't be surprised if the market tries to attempt scaling up a little higher from here on as well, maybe another 7 to 8%, 7 to 10% approximately, mainly on the back of two things. One is the fact that the economy, and not just India but even some of the other economies around the world, are trying to open up, and there are clearly pockets within India as well which have started to refunction. And the second, of course, being the fact that we have significantly underperformed as a market. I mean, as I was just looking at the numbers year to date, US, for all it is worth regarding the virus, is down just about 13% from its peak. And we are down about 26% from our peaks.
COVID caught us at a little bit of a low We've been more aggressive with our lockdown. And, you know, simultaneously, we've been a little bit more watchful with our financial support. So I think to some extent, I think this combination would have inevitably resulted in a certain level of underperformance, which is what we are in the midst of at this point in time. So I don't think it's that surprising. It would have caught up at some point in time.
The vaccine news. And the other one is that the reopening so far are proving to be relatively healthy. And importantly, if you look at the high frequency data, people are engaging, households are engaging, businesses are engaging. So both on the health side and the economy side, you're getting good news. And the big hope is we sustain it. The risk on is across the board. It's not just stocks, it's other risk assets, it's fixed income, it's currencies, and it's commodities. So it's really good to see an across the board risk on tone, which we haven't had really for quite a while.